el curso de biología 3102. Esta idea de esta conferencia surgió del doctor Ramírez y este servidor, que no sepan quién soy, soy Omar Pérez. Una de esos días, de esas tardes que uno se reúne en el estacionamiento de la facultad a mirar pajaritos volar, y nos surgió la idea de hacer unas conferencias para ustedes que conozcan los recursos que nosotros tenemos en el departamento y que tenemos aquí en la isla, recursos de investigación, recursos de mucho conocimiento científico, que no necesariamente siempre miramos más allá, y aquí esos recursos están. El primer conferenciante de hoy va a ser el doctor Jim Ackerman, que ahorita el doctor Lascano, estudiante doctoral del doctor Ackerman, lo va a presentar. Pero nada, quiero que sepan, estamos muy contentos de que estén aquí a las 5:30 de la tarde. Tomen sus notas, la conferencia es muy buena. Háganle preguntas al doctor Ackerman en plena confianza, así no tenemos que dar mucha clase después. Nada, estamos aquí, la doctora Camacho, la Daris Más, que se encuentra allá atrás, el doctor Lascano, Juan Sebastián, este servidor. Para cualquier duda, al final, el que estudiante que te quiera firmar las hojas de asistencia, al final afuera, firmamos. Pero ahora vamos a comenzar. Más el tubo, Julio.
Gracias.
Yo
soy Juan Ramírez, como le digo, yo soy uno de los compiladores de esta actividad, pero sin más preámbulo, lo dejo con Julio Lascano, profesor de muchos de ustedes, que va a presentar a nuestra conferencia anterior, que incluye.
Buenas tardes a todos. Es un inmenso placer para mí presentar hoy al doctor James Ackerman, también conocido como Jim. El doctor Ackerman es una persona que ha sido y continúa siendo excelente en el trabajo científico, en muchas formas de medirlo. En las formas, vamos a decir, más estándares de producción científica, como los artículos científicos, publicaciones, y en las formas menos estándares de medirlas, como lo que yo denomino, y algunas personas denominan igual, descendencia científica. La cantidad de estudiantes que él ha sido capaz de entrenar y de formar con una visión científica apropiada para salir al mundo y hacer sus investigaciones de manera independiente y ser exitosos haciendo investigaciones. En el plano más formal, Jim tiene, para hablar de números, algo más de 100 artículos científicos publicados sobre diversos temas de biología de plantas, esencialmente varios libros sobre diversos temas. Sus investigaciones tienen un rango muy amplio. Han ido desde la biología reproductiva, entendiéndose por biología reproductiva de plantas, desde polinización y polinizadores, insectos fundamentalmente, hasta caracteres que son relevantes en las plantas para tener una diferencia en su reproducción, algunas más, otras menos. El grupo de preferencia del doctor Ackerman son las orquídeas, un grupo fascinante desde el punto de vista estético, lo vemos y enseguida nos estamos enamorando. Sin embargo, la idea que tratamos de promover en este curso es que, más allá del placer estético, que es intuitivo, conocer sobre los grupos biológicos que ustedes van a estar estudiando les da un placer mucho mayor, hace el mundo más disfrutable, y lo hace más disfrutable para nosotros y para las personas que nos rodean. Jim también ha formado, o sea, no solo estudiantes de maestría y doctorado, niveles graduados, sino ha trabajado en la formación de muchos estudiantes subgraduados. O sea que si ustedes se sienten motivados con la charla que va a dar hoy para acercarse al laboratorio de biología integrativa, que es el laboratorio que él dirige, que está en el edificio Facundo Hueso, o al museo de zoología, que es otra institución que él dirige, que también en Facundo Hueso, ustedes se pueden acercar y van a ser bienvenidos como estudiantes de 4990. ¿Hay espacio?
Gracias.
Con ustedes.
Y You got your seat belts fastened? All right. This evening, whatever time this is, I'm going to talk about two things. I'm going to talk about Darwin, and I'm going to talk about orchids. Now, I hope you're able to figure this out because it's up there on the first slide. And I want to try to convey this idea of passion. Passion in what you do. Now, it wasn't too long ago, way back in the year 2009, we had some big, big anniversaries. Now, you guys were probably not here. At least I hope you're not. You are here. But at least in the university. But it was a big deal because the number one anniversary was the 200th birthday of Charles Darwin. He was born in 1809. And the second big anniversary was the 150th anniversary of the origin of species by means of natural selection. And in the fine print it says, on the preservation of favored races in the struggle for life. So it was very dramatic. And we've been celebrating these anniversaries, actually every year. Okay, but actually, the origin of species was extremely, extremely controversial at its time. It's a great theory, and some people really would have liked to kill Darwin. So, you know, what was the fuss all about? Why was it controversial? Well, all we have to do is we go back in time to the 18th century, and the early 19th century too. Naturalists during these times had a mission, and that mission was to describe the diversity of life, to demonstrate and reveal God's plan. That's what they did. And big players in this adventure in natural history, some of them came from the Caribbean. And as people explored throughout the world, including the Caribbean, one of the things that came to be was that life on the planet was far more diverse than anybody ever thought. Okay, here's one of the guys, Charles Plumier. He was not a very good looking guy, but he was romping around in the Caribbean, as was Nicolas Jacquin. I think Plumier was a Frenchman and Jacquin was from Belgium. Is that right? We have an expert on history of botanical history of the Caribbean right here amongst us. And Dr. Eugenio Santiago. Raise your hand, Eugenio. Okay, so that's the guy. You know. And then another guy was Olaf Schwartz. Olaf. Okay, and so these guys explored the islands of the Caribbean, and they collected lots of plants and sometimes collected animals as well. And when you're around the Caribbean a lot, there's one companion that's always with you. Captain Morgan, and he wasn't a naturalist at all. That's basically what they had to drink. All right, not Captain Morgan, then something better probably. It's made in the Virgin Islands now, not in Puerto Rico. So. All right. So, and one of the things about this diversity is patterns started to emerge. You know, certain plants seem to be able to group together. And we always like to classify things, you know. Oh, that's a pizza joint. That's a hamburger joint, you know. We're always classifying. Well, the naturalists way back when, up to this day, we're seeing patterns in all this diversity. And so the kind of the question was emerging, are different species related to one another like members of a family? And that's a radical thought, because the next question reveals it. Is descent with modifications possible? That is a radical thought, because previously we were describing the diversity of the world to reveal God's plan. But there seems to be some patterns here that perhaps would suggest something else. So, those things were happening around in the world of it's primarily Europe, let's face it. And then, and it was swirling. These ideas were starting to swirl at the time when Charles Darwin was born. Well, Darwin broke all odds and he survived. He went to college. Now, his grandfather, Erasmus, was a well-known physician, and so was his father, Robert. Okay? So, you know, they're medical doctors. They call them physicians at the time. So, if your father and your grandfather are doctors, they probably want you to be a doctor, too. Okay, how many pre-meds we have here? Only four or five. Oh, come on. You can raise the higher.
Please.
Want to take it higher? Can you see the movie Woodstock?
Momento, vamos a ver.
Okay, so how many of you have relatives that are doctors? Just about everybody. Okay, so you're just like Charles Darwin. So Charles Darwin, you know, of course, went off to medical school. All right. So he went off to medical school. Now, I'm sure all of you who are pre-meds are not going to fail. You're all going to pass gloriously. But I do want to point out that Charles Darwin was one of these very rare people that went to medical school and failed. He became a medical school dropout. Now, why was this the case? It was party time. You know, he got out of the house, he went to the university, he and his friends were having a great old time, and he just partied and partied. Never studied. Except that's not quite true. He was actually a nerd. And he and his friends, naturalist friends, went running around the countryside in England, collecting plants and animals and identifying them. They were having just a wonderful time. So he was extremely curious about everything around him, as long as it didn't entail a cadaver in some, you know, musty room at the university where lectures were given, just like this one, on medicine. Okay, so he was actually a nerd. All right, so needless to say, if you fail and your parents are doctors, they will be extremely disappointed in you. So I would suggest to you, all of you, study. Otherwise, you just may go to Bible school. And actually, this wasn't a bad thing to go to Bible school. It was to become a parson was a good profession for a gentleman. And Charles Darwin was not poor. His father and grandfather were physicians, after all. And then back then everybody went to church, so he sort of knew the Bible backwards and forwards. And so what did he do in Bible school? Well, just like in medical school, Charles Darwin, and his friends just went out to the English countryside and they collected plants and they collected animals and they identified them and they had a grand old time doing it. His behavior did not change. And as a consequence of that behavior, he learned a lot. He went running around with this guy named John Stevens Henslow, who had very radical ideas in his emerging field of natural theology. And that is, God is acting through the laws of nature rather than nature acting through the laws of God. Flipped it over. Completely radical thought. And those friends of Darwin and Darwin, they just loved Henslow. And so they went around the countryside collecting plants and animals, identifying them. And they ran around the countryside collecting plants and animals and identifying them. And they kept on doing this for however long it takes to become a parson. If you're going to Christ College in Cambridge, which was a very prestigious university. The amazing thing is, he graduated! And that's because he already knew the Bible, and he was really smart, and so he just crammed. I shouldn't do this to you guys. I am not advocating that you spend your time partying unless you're going out collecting plants and animals and identifying them. But he crammed for his exams and he's passed, and not only did he pass, he passed with an A, basically. He was 10% of his class. Pretty good, huh? So he and his friends, so influenced by Henslow, their great adventure. You graduate, you get to go to Europe or something, except they're already there. And so they wanted to go someplace different. They were going to go to, I think it was Africa. So their adventure was to go to Africa and collect plants and animals and identify them and bring them back to England. Okay, that was the plan. And unfortunately, Henslow, who thought Darwin was a pretty cool kid, Henslow wrote to a guy named Fitzroy. Captain Fitzroy, who is the captain. He was only 23 years old. He was already a captain in Her Majesty's or His Majesty's service. I remember if it was the king or queen at the time. Anybody know? How's your English history? Just like mine, huh? All right. But in any case, he was captain of the ship,
And Henslow wrote to him and said, hey, I've got a really good naturalist. Why don't you take him around the world and be your naturalist? And the Beagle was on a mission to survey the planet, basically. So Fitzroy interviewed Darwin, and they got along just fine. You know, Darwin's kind of a loose, you know, easygoing guy, and Fitzroy's sort of rigid character. But for some reason, the chemistry worked. Amazing. And so, you know, Fitzroy said, yeah, come along. Well, you know, Charles' father did not like the idea that his son is going to go around the world and take 2 years to do it. He primarily did not like the idea because he was going to pay for it. The queen or the king was not paying for this ride, but they certainly were going to benefit from it. So, after some convincing, you know, Henslow talked to, you know, Robert and said, hey, Robert, your son is a good kid. This is a great opportunity. You know, you really should do it. It's a great experience. You know, who knows? He might come back. You never know. And back then, that was, you know, a legitimate concern. You go around the world, you know, the chances of coming back might be kind of slim. So anyway, in the December 27th, 1831, they finally managed to shove off from Plymouth, southern England, and start their journey. And this is where they went. So they started over in... There's England. So they zipped on down to Brazil and hopped around, went through Tierra del Fuego, that area, up along Chile, and then over to the Galapagos. You've heard of that, right? And then from the Galapagos, the Society Islands, and then all the way across the Pacific, heading down to New Zealand, Australia. I don't know what this is. Is that Christmas Island? I'll have to check. And then Mauritius, and then South Africa, back across the Atlantic to Brazil and on North Pole. 2 years. And he was seasick the entire time. Yeah, imagine that. Or not. Okay. So during this voyage, he observed many, many things. And one of the things that he discovered was in way down in the southern, near the southern tip of South America, in Argentina, he found fossils. These fossils. This is a big animal. This is a fossil of one of those megafauna, Pleistocene megafauna, that have all disappeared. These big, tell them you're, you'll text them, you're going, I'm listening to the greatest lecture in the world. All right, so, he discovered these huge animals. I mean, the bones are just laying out there. In fact, I think there was some of it. I think there was a giant sloth with the hair was still on the fossil. Amazing stuff. These things did not exist before. I mean, they existed before. That's what I'm saying. They didn't exist at the time, that's what I mean. But there was evidence, skeleton, that these animals at one time existed, and not too long ago, because you know, one of them still has some hair. Okay, so that was one of the things. He discovered these fossils that suggested that life on this planet was different in the past than it is now. So that was like, whoa, okay. And then off to the Galapagos he went. And many of you probably heard about these things. Those are the finches, the famous Galapagos finches. And on the different islands of the Galapagos, there are different finches, and there's some islands and more species than others. And they and the different species had different shaped beaks. And it turns out the ones with a different shaped beak had different kinds of food or different kinds of habits. There's a lot of variation there. And so so off he collected all these things. He didn't take good notes. This is a real big problem. You probably heard of Galapagos finches because it played a central role in his theory on the origin of species. Except he couldn't have used these without the help of Fitzroy. Because Fitzroy, you know, is this very rigid guy. And so he took very meticulous notes about the operation of the ship, and he was actually, you know, interested in natural history too. And so he took notes and collected as well. But in his notes, he had notes for every finch and which island it came from. Darwin just said, "Oh, these are finches," and just put them in a big bucket. So it's actually when he got back that he had to sort them out and say, "Hey, it didn't have phone calls." they didn't have typewriters either. he wrote, Fitzroy said, "Hey, can you help me out this? These finches all look actually kind of different. Do you know which islands they came from?" And so Fitzroy bailed them out there. Anyway, so those are a couple pieces that there's substantial variation going on, and that these things look like they could be from the same family, like Goldie Hawn and her daughter. Anyway. Okay. Darwin was not just interested in fossils, but he was also interested in plants and animals, living ones, and geology. Because as a natural historian, geology was a big deal to study. And study he did. One of the things that he noticed that, some of the mountains looked amazing, especially going through the Tierra del Fuego, the Straits of Magellan. The mountains are really sharp. Not rounded, not much erosion, suggesting that perhaps these are relatively young mountains. And then he was such an astute observer of coral reefs when he was going through the tropics across the Pacific. He kind of figured out how islands evolve. They start out as volcanoes. Like this, with a little edge of coral. And then sea level changes or erosion occurs, and then you have these lagoons form, big lagoons. And eventually, they subside, and all you have left is a coral reef. And those are the atoll. You've heard of Bikini Atoll, haven't you? Yeah. What's on Bikini Atoll? Huh? Okay, Bikini Atoll. Bikini Atoll is like, it's like one of these islands. And this one is famous because it has a lot of this. What does it have a lot of?
Radiation. That's where they were doing the atomic bomb testing there.
Maybe that's why SpongeBob lived. I mean, you have to have tremendous insight to be able to observe islands and then come up with this, which turns out to be true. So, yeah, it was amazing. All right. So while Charles was running around barking over the edge of the beagle, and spending 2 years doing that, there's lots of intellectual activity going on in Europe, including people like Lamarck and Darwin's grandfather, in fact. They had very radical ideas that change occurs. Now, Lamarck didn't have it quite right. You know, he had, classic example of the giraffes with the long neck. The more you stretch it, the longer it gets, and then this is somehow passed on from generation to generation. You notice that too? Okay, so he had the genetics wrong, the mode of inheritance wrong. But the idea is that there is descent with modification. Okay. All right. There's another piece to this puzzle. It's that there's this mathematician, statistician, mouthpiece. That guy kind of looks like a mathematician, doesn't it? No, I think today's mathematicians work a little crazier than that, actually. Oh, just wait until you start taking some math at this university and you'll know what I'm talking about. Okay, so this is the deal. He noticed that populations grow exponentially. There's the line.
Yeah.
Up the throat. But actually, they don't do that. If you look at populations, they may reach that logarithmic phase, but then somehow they level off, or maybe even crash. So there are factors that prevent the world from having populations that do this. And here's one factor, food. Okay, if you are a predator and there's lots of food around, oh, you just eat and you have sex, and then you eat and eat and you have sex, you have babies, more babies, and they're having sex, well, when you get old. and so you get this logarithmic growth. There's lots of food. But once that food line crosses the population line, we got big problems. Alright? That means there's competition. Something's gonna happen. And it ain't going to be good. Alright. So Darwin was aware of this. And so I already mentioned this a number of times. There's a couple of students over here in the corners. I'm watching periodically, make sure they're not asleep. Darwin noticed that sex was everywhere. Animals did it. Plants did it. It was amazing.
and that he also noted, as he did,
he had a bunch of children. Most of them did not survive. But those were kind of like hunters. Even though his father and his grandfather were doctors, it didn't help that much.
But anyway, so sex was going on, but some sex is better than other sex. No? Okay, but you know, the idea is that if you have sex with yourself, it's not as good as having sex with I'm sorry, I'm thinking like a botanist here. And as you will learn in this class, that plants can, there is a possibility that plants can have sex with themselves. And in fact, earthworms can do it too, right? Yeah, Omar says yeah. But most of the time, with animals, when you have sex with closely related people, the progeny will look not quite right. So, in fact, they may not survive at all. But if you have sex with someone outside your family, we could be talking plants as well as animals, then your progeny are usually quite vigorous and much more healthy. This is something that Darwin noticed. I keep on doing this. When am I going to learn? Well, did I just do a speech? Now I just learned not to hit the escape button. What do you guys see? Okay, we got some more pieces to the puzzle coming up. Okay, so not only did he find that there was sex going on, and that some sex is better than other sex, but he also noticed in populations that individuals look different. Do we have any identical twins in here? Where's your sister? Look at that. They have the same genotype. All right. Now, without them, the rest of you look very different. Okay? Right? I mean, even if your clothes are different, even if everybody took their clothes off and on, I'm not suggesting that. If you had your clothes off, you would still see that we're all very, very different. So there's a lot of variation going on, and here's one of the most fabulous examples of how much variation there is can be in a population, besides, of course, this room. And that is, there's a population I ran across when I was in Cuba, over in Camagüey, in a mangrove swamp, which actually was dying. But living on the trees in the mangrove swamp was this species of Colombia. Now, if I didn't know that these things were growing all together and all intermixed, I would say, oh, I've got at least a dozen different species here. Tremendous amount of variation. I would just love to get back there and sample that population and do some DNA analysis. But not me. I don't do that. But I've got friends. And that's the important thing, that you've got to have friends in this game. But we're getting off the track. So this Tolomia lucaeta, these flowers of a single population, lots of variation. And the big question is, Who wins? I have a question up here. You could hold me. All right. Who wins the struggle for existence? Not all of these forms are going to be successful. So what are the factors that determine who is successful and who isn't? Well, I keep on going back. Okay, so after he got back, 2 years later, finally came back home to the townhouse in England, and he started putting all these pieces together. This story about, you know, there's life in the past is not the same as it was at present, all about this variation and how sex is important, especially sex between unrelated individuals. All these things. And he started doing experiments. He did experiments with domesticated animals and with plants. He bred pigeons. You know, these pigeons here are all the same species. You just select some really weird form, and then you breed it, and pretty soon you get these, you know, really bizarre looking pigeons. That's pretty awesome. Anybody here have a dog? All right, Sockos, I imagine. Anybody have a chihuahua? Oh, good Lord, that's just great. All right, and what about a Great Dane? We have one Great Dane and the little chihuahuas. Or two. They're the same species, my friends. Just breeding. We did that. Okay. All right, this is Darwin's house. And this is his study. I guess you can't see this very well. And I'll read the quote down below. I mean, here, this is really cool. Here's his chair. He's not sitting on a desk. He's using the coffee table, you know? And just like I do at home. And all these books all around. I'd have a hammock myself, but, you know, when you get tired, it's a mess, right? If a cluttered desk is the sign of a cluttered mind, of what then is an empty desk a sign? Charles Darwin did not say that. That was Albert Einstein. So the next time someone complains that your desk is cluttered, you say, yes, I do have a cluttered mind, but you know, what is the option? Okay, back at home in England, at the townhouse. So there was an area near his house that he called the orchid bank. It's because it was loaded with native orchids. And he thought, whoa, you see, eventually I'd get around the orchids. You knew I would, right? So he became very interested in orchids, and he started doing experiments with them. And one of the things that he noticed, that orchid fruits have lots of seeds. Let me go back to this one. This is an orchid fruit that was, you know, ripped open somewhat. And these are the seeds. There are thousands of seeds in that one little fruit. And of course, every flower on that inflorescence there is potentially will produce a fruit for the pollen. Okay? So you have thousands of seeds per fruit, you have dozens of flowers on an inflorescence. If all those flowers produce fruits, all those fruits have seeds, and if every seed survives, in just a few generations. Just a few generations. This planet will look like a outside to find out if the place is covered with English orchids. Obviously this doesn't happen. So some seeds are winners, most of them are not. Okay? So what keeps English plants from covering the planet? Which one of those thousands and thousands of seeds will actually survive? This is the big question. There is so much variation out there. Which one will be selected? And what will the consequences be? That's the big question. So Darwin started putting all pieces of his puzzle together and realized that he had an explanation for biological diversity. And that explanation he published. In fact, he was inspired to publish because there's another guy named Alfred Wallace that was thinking along the same lines as Darwin. And Wallace wrote Darwin a letter. Hey, I'm thinking about this and that, and this and that. And Darwin was going, oh my God, I'm going to be scooped. And so what they did was they had a joint paper read. They didn't read the paper themselves. In fact, I don't think Wallace was in England at the time. But at the Linnaean Society, somebody, do you remember who read that paper? I don't remember. I'm sure it was somebody absolutely important. I've been in that room, in the Linnaean house, where that was done. Totally. But the benches were really hard. Anyway, so they had a joint paper read. This is in 1858. And then Darwin had to rush to print his book. And his book, do I dare touch this thing again? You like that, huh? So he decided to write an abstract. A 450 page abstract. You try to write an abstract like that, and your editor say, 450 page abstract? I am sorry, you don't even get 450 words from your abstract. But that's what it was. It was an abstract. And in this abstract, he described natural selection. Now I'm going to tell you what natural selection is in modern terms. It's not the way he described it, but it's all there. Okay. Natural selection is not the survival of the fittest. Of course, you cannot define what something is by when it's not. So I'll tell you what it is. Natural selection has three conditions. And the number one condition for natural selection to occur, variation. You must have variation. variation within a species, but most importantly, variation within a population. So we have lots of variation in this room. We got the first step. The second important thing, you want to write this down, because I am slowing down to emphasize that this is actually important. That variation must be inheritable. Okay? All right? Now, some variation is due to genetics. All of us, except you two up there, all of us are different from one another. Okay? That is probably due to genetics. We don't have the same genes. And then some of the variation is due to other factors, like we're all dressed differently. I don't think anybody here is dressed the same, exactly. Okay. So, it is variation that is inheritable variation that is important. So we have two conditions. Number one condition, you have variation, and number two condition, that variation must be inherited, must have a genetic basis for it. And then the third one is fitness differences, and we can get fitness differences, for example, by mate selection. Who are you gonna mate with? Go ahead, look around the room, check everybody out. All right? Is it going to be this guy who's lots of fun and adventurous, goes around the world, barks all over the place? Or this guy who loves music, but wears more eyeshadow than you do? Or this guy with brains and humor. It's your choice. But actually, sometimes it's male choice. In fact, what is the sex ratio at this university? This student body? What is the sex ratio? Look around you. Mostly females in this class? Yeah. Sex ratio is running close to 70% female, 30% male. We have runaway sexual selection going on here. There's a tremendous competition for males. Males at this university, you know, get the two. Okay, so there are winners and there are losers. Okay? So some of you will get to reproduce and others will not, either by choice or not. Okay, so those are the three conditions. Variation, inheritable variation, and that there are differences amongst the variants of who is successful, who is not. These are fitness differences. So if we know those three things, we can accurately predict what the next generation will look like. And that next generation may actually look the same as the first generation, or it's different. And if the next generation is different, then that is evolution. Simple. Okay? And Darwin was claiming that natural selection is the primary means, in fact, I think the only means in which change can occur, evolution can occur. But we know now that there are some other factors involved, but still, natural selection is the biggie. Okay? All right, there's Darwin's finches again, but probably... Okay. So I will go into some stories about Darwin. But you know, I wasn't kidding about this abstract business, a 450-page abstract. After he published that abstract, then the book started coming. I'll read them off to you. Fertilization of Orchids, Charles Darwin. Climbing Plants, Charles Darwin. Animals and Plants Under Domestication, Volume 1. Animals and Plants Under Domestication, Volume 2. Insectivorous Plants. Really like plants. Cross and Self-Fertilization in the Vegetable Kingdom. Plants again. Forms of Flowers. Plants again. The Movements of Plants. Plants again. Vegetable Mold and Earthworms.
And vegetable mold, of course, is more related to animals than it is to plants.
But and he wrote some other things, Descent of Man, and things like that. But the idea is that what he did as an abstract, he then published the data for that abstract in these books. Okay. And in fact, the Origin of Species has very few references to plants. He hardly talks about plants at all. It's almost all animals. But Charles Darwin actually wanted to publish an entire chapter on orchids. And his editor, his publisher said, I want to sell some books. Just keep it all animals, and I promise you, you can publish other books on your plants. Okay? Charles Billy. So the orchid part went out. It would have been a long chapter, because that very first book that came out after The Origin of Species was the various contrivances by which orchids are fertilized by insects. That's the very first book. And the question, of course, is why was Darwin so interested in orchid pollination mechanisms? All right? And it's because orchids were some of the most bizarre flowering plants. And he not only saw orchids from the countryside in England, which are interesting, but they really don't match what you find in the tropics. But people were bringing orchids into the greenhouses at the Royal Botanic Gardens at Kew, and he had he had friends everywhere, and so they would bring him orchids. And so he saw a tremendous diversity of orchids. And he studied the flowers of orchids, and he realized that all the mechanisms for pollination, and pollination is the transfer of pollen, which will produce the sperm cells for fertilization, the transfer of pollen from one flower to another flower of another plant. That's pollination. Taking pollen from one flower, moving it to the stigma, the receptive area of the other flower. Then the pollen tubes will germinate, and those tubes will grow down, and then there's some cells in there that will divide and form sperm cells, and they will fertilize the ovules. Okay. He recognized that all these bizarre features of orchids is related to increasing the probability of cross-pollination. Mating with relatives, bad news. Mating with other individuals, good news. Remember that from earlier this evening? Here's an example. This is an orchid flower where most of the parts are cut away, except that
business end up here. This is where the pollen is, and over here is where the stigma is. Okay. The idea is to get that pollen out of here, and don't put it there because that's selfing. You want to take that, go someplace, right like there, and cross-pollinate. So a bee goes into this flower and is looking for nectar over here.
May or may not be there.
He's looking for nectar, and as he comes out of the flower, he first passes the stigma right here. And if he's carrying any pollen, the pollen gets stuck on the stigma. And then as his last move before leaving the flower, he comes in contact with the pollen and picks up a new mass of pollen. In orchids, the pollen is not powdery. It's in clumps. We call pollinium. And if you put a pencil into this flower, what will happen? You put it in the flower and then take it out, then you get the pollen masses. And they're standing up straight. So if you go to another flower of the same plant, that those pollen masses stay up straight. And because the position of the insect, the pollen masses will not get the stigma. But over time, they bend. You see in figure eight, they bend. And so when the pollinator goes in, now the pollen masses are right in line with touching the stigma. But time, it takes time to do this. You know, maybe 30 minutes, maybe 15 minutes, maybe 10 minutes. But no pollinator is going to hang around the same inflorescence for that long of a period of time. So he's flying, or she, likely she's flying to another plant. And by the time the pollen masses are in the right position, it's at a different plant. Cross-pollination. This is amazing mechanism to assure the probability of cross-pollination. And so this entire book that he wrote on the various contrivances by which orchids are fertilized by insects is describing these amazing mechanisms. And if these mechanisms can be so amazing, then there must be very strong selection for these features, for these plants to evolve like this. Okay, that is why the very first book that came out, The Origin of Species, the very first book that had the evidence for natural selection was about orchids. Okay. And just to throw in a couple stories about orchids. Here's one. This is probably one of the most amazing stories. This is Coriandes from Central and South America. It is known as the bucket orchid. Because, you know, one of the petals is formed like a bucket. Alright? And so you have this bucket, and in the bucket, it's like you guys, you know, you fill up your buckets full of water because there's nothing coming out of the tap. Well, actually, something comes out of the tap in this orchid. There are little structures, these little bumps here. Little bump there. That little bump is a faucet. It drips water. So the plant is getting the water from the roots, translocating it up to the xylem, to these glands, and then exuding the water, and it fills up the bucket. I like your hat. Alright, so now what happens? We have pollinators. These pollinators are gorgeous. Sometime if you're near my office, I'll show you some of these pollinators. They're called the glossing bees, or more commonly known as orchid bees. for the relationship with orchids.
That's another
thing. But what they do, these male bees, they're looking for perfumes. They collect perfumes. It's like they're going to Penny's and they're going to the perfume department and they're collecting different kinds of fragrances. And those fragrances are liquid. That's how it starts out. So the orchid is producing, has glands and they're producing this liquid. But as you know, perfume evaporates. So it evaporates very quickly.
These bees can detect it.
I go, oh, do you smell that? And they head for these plants, and they're seeking certain compounds. So they get on this on the plant, and they have their front legs are modified like mops, and they're mopping up all these fragrances. And then when they get ready to transfer these mops to their hind legs, that spongy thing is inside. That's an exoskeleton. And they transfer the compounds in their hind legs. But they can't do that while they're walking around. They have to launch off the flower, hover, and they do the transfer. And then they go back and collect some more. But when they're in just the right position inside this flower, they launch off the flower and they hit the side of the flower, they fall down right into the spa, swimming pool, whatever you want to call it. And of course they're swimming. Fortunately, there's a way out. Only one way out. And it crawls up the side inside of the flower. It first goes past the stigma. It's carrying pollen into the flower. Then just as it leaves, it picks up a new set of pollen masses. So, in fact, here's a little beast right there. I know you can't see it, but it's sort of greenish. Most of them are green. There's colored all kinds of colors. And this one is hovering and ready to, well, it's transferring compounds, ready to go get some more. So, falls down into the bucket, crawls out, goes right past the stigma, and then the anther pick up the new pollen, and off it goes, flying to another place. To another plant, presumably. That is pretty amazing, right? Right?
Yes!
Don't worry, I'm almost over. Are you getting hungry?
Yes.
Who's cooking tonight? Okay, one last example. This is the Madagascar star orchid. And Greekum sesquipedale. Can you say that? It blooms at night. Well, the flowers are open day and night. The flowers last for a long time, a couple of weeks. And the flowers are these heavy, waxy things, but it produces this tremendous fragrance at night. Why would they produce a fragrance at night? To attract pollinators at night. Who are the nighttime pollinators? Bats. Who else? Moths. Yeah. Well, it's not a bat that's doing this because the fragrance of bat flowers are kind of funky. They smell really good. But this thing is a very powerful, strong fragrance. And so Darwin had an idea of who this pollinator was. Okay. The Madagascar star orchid. Back in 1862, the first edition of the He got the plan from Hugh Burgess. He didn't go to Madagascar. Well, actually, he did go to Madagascar. But he didn't see the orchid there. He suggested that a hawk moth of the family Sphingidae is a pollen. Now, these are strong flyers, and they're sort of the big moths of the moth world. And they're kind of like hummingbirds, in a sense. If a moth could be a hummingbird, that's what these things were. I mean, and that this moth had a proboscis long enough to reach the nectar in the flower. So here we are, Madagascar star orchid. We have petals, we have sepals, and then we have this funny long thing here. It's called a spur. And at the very tip of that spur is nectar. And you have to have a tongue, or proboscis, a tongue that is 22 centimeters long. How long is that? What's his name, Simmons? Never mind. Okay, so Darwin's prediction. There was a hawk moth, a spigid, had to exist with a proboscis long enough to reach the nectar. And the problem was, of course, that no such moth existed at the time. So the entomologists, those are people that study insects,
you go, oh man, you really went off the end, you know, Charles. Yeah, this is not right. Because it will.
But this is what the plan tells me. I predict that this is going to, you're going to find this beast. In fact, 40 years later, 41 years later, sure enough, they finally found the moth in Madagascar with a tongue 22 centimeters long. There's that thing. And the entomologist named it after Darwin. They considered a variety of a species. Xanthopan morgan, right? Variety Praedicta. Now, Praedicta is not Darwin's name, obviously, but it commemorates the prediction of the existence of this beast. And in fact, it wasn't until less than 10 years ago when we actually saw it in action. And it was filmed, the doctors. And here it is. Here's a hawk moth hovering in front of the flower, putting its tongue in the flower, and then that tongue will go right down into the spur, and the head of the moth will contact the sexual parts of the flower. Pick up the pollen. That truly is. Okay. So I would hold to you that Darwin's favorite system is orchids. And in fact, there are letters that he has written that express that, which I was trying to find for you. But it definitely is one of his favorites. And in fact, at the beginning of, I'm very excited to see my insects, he writes, the contrivances by which orchids are fertilized are as varied and almost as perfect as any of the most beautiful adaptations in the animal kingdom. That was right at the beginning of this book. Convincing, trying to convince people, it's not all about animals. Plants are truly amazing. And orchids are truly beautiful. Thank you very much. It's been wonderful.
thought, what the hell, you know? You can email me if you have any questions or whatever.
Jim. Con permiso, Jim. Acá hay una.
Ajá. Yeah? No. Well, this, what they have is, it gets better and better, I'm telling you. What they have on those pollen masses is a little stalk. Many of them have a little stalk. And at the stalk, there's a little, there's some glue. And the glue is behind the little membrane. And if the pollinator hits that membrane, it breaks, and the glue is fast-acting glue. It's super glue. The stuff gets stuck on it, and it cements right to the pollinator. Usually here, back here, over on the butt, on the knees, lots of different places where they get stuck. The stigma, you're asking me how does it pollen? The stigma has polysaccharides, the sugary kinds of compounds, and they, when the pollen masses touch that, that's sticky too. And so it's almost like a cement, but it remains sticky. And the pollen masses get there, and as the pollinator leaves, the pollen gets ripped off from the stalk that held it. So that gets stuck on there, and then I'm telling you, competition kicks in big time, because those pollen masses, pollinia we call them, they can have tens of thousands, even more than that, millions of pollen grains. And they are all rushing down that stile, rushing to those ladies. And the best ones get there first, and they are the ones that are mating. So there's a lot of mates, a lot of competition going on just within a single flower. That answer the question? Mahalo. All right. He ate before he came here.
A lot of people say that in one of the hormones they hear in the menstruation cycle is the galactose because of the great biodiversity. Besides the patients, do you think that he has another reference in which he wants to communicate?
I didn't quite. I'm sorry.
And people often say that the Galapagos Island was one of Darwin's favorite investigative sites because of its biodiversity.
Right.
The fishes. Is there any other animal you really like to investigate in the island?
Well, he investigated tortoises, for example, the giant tortoises, and they are different from one island to the next. He also looked at the iguanas. The marine iguanas are quite different from the iguanas that he saw on the mainland. So there's lots of different things that he observed that reinforces the finch idea. So the finches, for some reason, they get a lot more press than the tortoises, but it's pretty much the same story. And
gracias, muchachos. Gracias, gente, por estar aquí.